Teil nach rechts, bitte.
Taxe Mücke. So it's great to be back to Stockholm, in particular in the summer. Full disclosure, so after moving from Sweden to Switzerland, I took over the directorship of the Study Center Gürtensee, which is a foundation of the Swiss National Bank, and I'm also a professor in Bern. I've been interested in the discussions about Vollgeld, all of you know about that, happening in Switzerland up to last year. I've been very skeptical in the public discussion on that one. I've been much more open in the discussion about CBDC, and I'm a absolutely orthodox mainstream economist, so nothing exciting to expect from that side. And by the way, since you, most of you, I think, are in favor of CBDC, I just want to mention right at the beginning that I like to mention, or I like to talk about that as reserves for all, so I would just suggest maybe to think about adopting that convention when you want to push this notion. Maybe it could politically help to call this reserves for all. That's how I like to think about it. So I'm asked to discuss this topic, and the background where I'm coming from is that we know there's people who argue that the introduction of reserves for all are a complete game changer, solves many problems, improves welfare of many agents in the economy. There's many people who argue the opposite, that it's a disaster, that it would crash the banking system and be the end of the world, so to speak. And of course, you might take the view that these guys are, some of these are evil, or maybe both sides are evil, or you might have the view that, you know, they just make different assumptions, and I guess that's the point that I'm, or the view that I'm trying to adopt here. So when people think about adopting CBDC and the macroeconomic consequences of this, typically you have to make some auxiliary assumptions, how you do this and what accommodating policies you adopt at the same time. And these auxiliary assumptions can have a big impact, can make a big difference. So what I want to start out from then to frame the discussion, to make it useful in my perspective, is to think about a first big question. Can we think about a world in which the introduction of CBDC actually doesn't make a change? Under what assumptions or what conditions would it take such that such a change of system would not actually change equilibrium outcomes that we care about? And once we understand what exactly these conditions are, what these assumptions that we implicitly take or not take are, then we can start to debate whether these assumptions are reasonable, whether they're plausible or not, and then we can have a better structured discussion about whether CBDC is a good idea or a bad idea. And the main message I want to convey here right away is that my perspective, and that is backed up in some research that I'm happy to talk about, would be that under relatively general circumstances, we can always think about particular policies that would have the effect that the introduction of CBDC, so a swap of public for private money, coupled with these accommodating policies, would actually not change macroeconomic outcomes as a benchmark, so to speak. So the question then is, of course, are these reasonable assumptions, are these reasonable conditions? Let me just try to make the argument very briefly, and it touches a bit on what Michael just showed us, I think. Number one, you can always engineer such a change of regime in a way that does not redistribute wealth. Of course, you can do it in ways that redistribute wealth, but you can also do it in ways that do not redistribute wealth. Number two, you can also do it in ways such that the means of payment restrictions that people face, the reason that people do use money, because they have to use it if they want to transact, can also be unaffected, in effect, even if you do such a swap. And that means that essentially the possibilities that the individual agents face, their choice sets, economists would say, they're unchanged, or you could make them unchanged after such a change of regime. That means that, ceteris paribus, they would continue to make the same choices. On top of this, not only the individuals would like to do the same changes subject to these accommodating policies, but on top of that, and I think this is also a very reasonable assumption, the resource requirements of CBDC as opposed to, say, deposits as a means of payment are very similar. So it's not that they would enter the resource constraints very, very dramatically different. So also from an aggregate resource point of view, there's no first order difference between these different means of payment. So if you put that together, you can make this much more watertight. You conclude that there's always, under very general conditions, ways to actually guarantee equivalence if you want to do that. This is a very simple picture that gives you one way to think about this, a very much Mickey Mouse way to think about it. Of course, if you want to argument seriously, then you have to go much more in detail, but it's a way to think about it. Doesn't CBDC undermine credit and financial stability, as we often hear from the opponents? And the answer is, again, as I just tried to argue, no, not necessarily if you adopt an accommodating monetary fiscal policy that comes with that. And again, the Mickey Mouse way to think about it would be the following. You have here a balance sheet of the banking sector, of a bank, say. This is the consolidated government, including the central bank. This is the household sector. Suppose I want to move from a situation in which the household sector that used to hold that much private money and this much public money, I want them to hold more public money and less private money. So typically, the way that I think everybody would agree on that is that the central bank would have to issue additional liabilities. The public money has to come from somewhere. And since we have this change in the composition of money held by the household sector, the deposit base of the banking sector would shrink. Now, this is where many arguments stop. Many arguments stop of the people who are concerned about that way, because they say, well, you know, banks have less funding, and we have these lots of liabilities of the government sector, so isn't that a problem? But of course, when you assume that the liabilities of the central bank or the government sector expand, you have to ask necessarily also, where does this funding go through, right? Where do these additional sources of fund are being invested in the new situation? You cannot think just about this, you also have to think about the other. And one way to guarantee equivalence under rather general conditions is one maybe implausible, maybe not realistic, but certainly conceptually possible, and that's what Michael mentioned before, is that essentially the central bank rechannels all these funds back into the banking sector, which means that the ownership or the composition of the deposit base of the banking sector has changed. It's no longer households, but now it's households and the central bank that invest in the banks. But for those guys, there's no sense in which the deposit base breaks away or the sources of funding break away. That's not going to happen. At least it's not going to happen necessarily, and it's a choice of the policymakers whether they want that to happen or not. So what would be happening if we were to implement this is simply that all these implicit guarantees that we have today, and this is, again, simplifying, but let me simplify a bit here, rendering them explicit, right? You make implicit government guarantees and debt explicit. That's what's going to happen if you were to run such a pass-through policy. And if you were to take that seriously, the obvious answer to the typical concern that runs are going to be much more likely if you adopted such a CBDC is that, so what, right? There's not an issue in the first place, because the very act of me transferring funds from my Citibank account deposits into CBDC, the very act of that immediately implies that the central bank is refunding Citibank. So there's, you might say that there is an issue about, again, that the central bank is invested in the bank and that the ownership of these deposit changes, but there's not necessarily, logically necessarily, any sense in which the funding base collapses. And if you're interested to make this much, much more precise and formal, then there's papers by Markus Brunnemeyer and myself, and also by myself, more of a policy paper. So I don't want to convince you that this is the most realistic way to think about it, but I want to convince you that as an analytical and conceptual benchmark, this is useful to think about, because out of this analysis, you will now get a couple of conditions or assumptions that need to be satisfied in order for such an equivalence to be guaranteed. And now we can start debating those, not many, like a couple of assumptions, and see whether these are realistic assumptions, whether we buy into them or whether we not buy into them. And in those papers, we do that. Now I want to move a bit more to the applied debate. After I tried to convince you that not necessarily CBDC would be a game changer, I'm now asking, you know, should we nevertheless expect CBDC to be a game changer, or at least change macro outcomes? And I think, yes, we should expect it to change outcomes, because I don't think that this accommodating policy that I tried to sketch you just a minute before would be the policy that would be adopted in, let me call it, politico-economic equilibrium. And for two reasons. The first reason is that new policy options are available, right? I mean, Michael described some of them. You have new government instruments, you're allowed to play with different instruments, with different interest rates, you could impose maybe quotas, you can do many, many more things. Some of them might be good choices, some of them might be bad choices. So in principle, the choice set of the policymakers opens up. This can be good news if you believe that policymakers are clever and benevolent. It could also be bad news if you think that they don't understand and that they screw up. So whether this is, you know, speaking in favor of CBDC or not, I don't know. It depends on your view of how the political process or the decision-making process works. At the Riksbank, we can be, I guess, very optimistic. In other countries, maybe we would be less optimistic. More interestingly, maybe, is that not only you have these additional policy choices, but you also get very, very different political constraints in such a world. And I think this is first order, if you think about CBDC. And what I have in mind here is for example, the fact that when I go back to my benchmark scenario that I sketched two slides ago, if we wanted to implement the equivalent allocation, we would have the central bank fund the banking sector. And actually, they would have to do it exactly under the same conditions as currently households are funding the banking sector through deposits. Is that something that we would expect in political equilibrium to occur, to take place? And the answer is obviously no, right? If it's very transparent that banks are funded at relatively cheap rates, typically, although in that CBDC regime, it's much less obvious why they should be funded at so low rates, since it's not them really that create liquidity in the sense that we think about it, right? There would be, I would expect at least, a lot of political pressure to change that, right? To change the conditions under which this funding is going to the banks. And therefore, you know, there's reasons to expect that this equivalent outcome is not the one that we would expect in equilibrium to happen. Should you favor CBDC? I think it very much depends on who you are, right? And most of you, I understand, like it, would like the idea. I think many of you would probably think this is also what was a major motivation, I believe, in the Swiss Vollgeld debate, that this is a way to, you know, fight the big banks, the bad banks, the bankers, the fat cats. I think it's not obvious that these are the ones that would suffer in the end. It could well be the depositors that suffer. It could well be the guys that, you know, are the ones that are funded by banks. It depends very much on the on the competitive structure in the banking system. Who would actually bear the costs of that? So it's not obvious, I believe. I think it's reasonable to expect that taxpayers might benefit. I think it's reasonable to expect that, in particular, once you have more transparency, the social and the private incentives are better aligned. So if you have a really, really benevolent macro perspective behind the wheel of ignorance, I think it's plausible to expect that this could improve outcomes. But again, I don't think there's any necessity in that happening. Central bankers obviously are very, very fearful of that because, I mean, they don't know what is happening exactly. There is a possibility to replicate current outcomes. There's many, many possibilities of not replicating current outcomes and get something which is totally unknown. And if I were in charge, I think I would be very hesitant. As an academic, I would love it, in particular if it's happening in some other country. So it pretty much depends on who you are. My sense of where we are moving and whether we should move there is that we will certainly see lots of change in the monetary regime. We've heard about many, many different aspects of that today. We will see the monetary system change, so or the other way. And my main question, or my main, I guess, perspective would be that we have to be clear whether we want the public, the government, to be a major player also in the future in the monetary system. There are some central banks which are rather proactive. You know that some have issued CBDC, many are thinking about it, many are very hesitant, as I just described. In the end, my personal view would be that we should aim for central bankers to remain major players in the financial sector. That to me means they should continue to issue cash. They should also continue or start issuing CBDC. But that is really my personal assessment after weighing all the different scenarios that I can think of. I don't think there is any good foundation at that point that would let us logically conclude that this is the way that we should go. My gut feeling would be that I would rather live in a monetary system in which central banks are a major player, and that in my view requires that they are at least somehow engaged in the CBDC business, than in which we have only private players taking, you know, the actions in the banking sector. So that's about it. Thank you.